Hi, welcome to my talk, the third one here in the Android track. Where's the focus? Yeah, as you should know, as you introduced me, I'm going to talk about Android Wear, or how I like to call it, Android as it gets worn, because I think Android Wear differentiates it too much from what it actually is. But yeah, so that's me. As you can see, I'm quite enthusiastic about Android in general, and yeah, I'm working as an Android developer at Jimdo, a startup in Hamburg, and as I'm also interested to help on exchanging knowledge and ideas and so on, I can skip the slide, right? Yeah, I co-founded the GGBM in Hamburg, so come by in Hamburg, come to our meetup, and next year maybe we'll see each other at our DevFest. But let's start with Android Wear. This photo got taken a few months back at the Jimdo office, right before lunch. That's our mobile team. I guess you all know this situation. So what mobile did the last years is pretty awesome. So we all get the information that gets sent to us immediately. We can see it immediately, interact on it. That's quite awesome. But there's also a negative side to it. So what happens when you get a notification? You just don't look at the notification. You do it, but you also look at other apps, at streams, Twitter, Facebook, Google+, whatever, and see, look up a lot of information that you maybe don't really need in that situation, because you could talk to other people, right? So, and that's where Android Wear wants to improve our lives. So, here again, what happens with the phone is you get a notification, you get out your phone, take a look at this notification, maybe you swipe it away because you don't care, and then you have your phone out, you take a look at this application and go into it, and it sucks a lot of time from you. So, and with Android Wear, it's different. You see just one small piece of information, you decide if you want to interact with it, and if not, you just swipe it away and you go on with your life. But let's compared a bit more. So that's the experience we have on the phone. We trained all our users to collect these shiny icons, these shiny items in a huge drawer, and always, all the time when they want to use it, they go to the drawer or to the home screen, look for it and start it, and that's actually time consuming. So when we would do this on a wear device, it would look like this, and that's not what you want to do there. I mean, it's time consuming, and this device got created to reduce the interaction with technology, not to just do the same. I mean, then you can just use your phone. It doesn't make sense. But how do we get out of this paradigm? So that's why Google developed this completely new UI. It's completely different UX, a completely different experience to what you have on your phone. It works on round and square devices, and it's really built just for small pieces of information and some micro interactions with them. So the interface has basically two main entry points. That's the context stream. You can see here, that's basically a vertical list of cards. And yeah, vertically, you can swipe from one to the next, and horizontally, you can do interactions with them. So when you swipe it to the right, you see the notification actions, and when you swipe it to the left, then you dismiss it like you would do on the phone. So it also, this notification also gets dismissed on the phone. So it also shows, tries always to show a visual background to support the content, so that you can just take a short look and even without reading, immediately see what's going on there. So ideally, you wouldn't look for your apps and start apps, but take a short look and see one small piece of information related to a current location or to the current time. So, and the second approach, the second entry to use Android Wear is the so-called cue card. That, yeah, you can think of it a bit as the app launcher, but it's different. It's It's built for using voice actions. So you can start it by tapping on the screen or by just saying, OK, Google. Okay. And yeah, then you do voice actions, and each action should trigger an intent. And you can use these intents to react on them just on a normal phone with intent filters and so on. Yeah, but what's Android Wear technically? So it's basically the same platform, the same OS, the same APIs, the same tools you use for development, but it's it has its own SDK level, 20, and it's called 4.4W2. That's so it's one kind of KitKat. And yeah, but there are some differences for development. So for example, it misses some packages, some APIs. For example, there's no WebKit, no WebView, no hybrid apps, yay. And of course, you cannot do print stuff there, app widgets, and so on. But what you wouldn't expect is that it still has APIs for Wi-Fi or for the camera. So all this stuff is in there in SDK level 20. So when manufacturers would want to build devices that have a camera on the watch, they could do it. That's not what Google intends to use it for, but Android is open, so manufacturers could do it. So, and what you need to have when you want to make use of these devices, you need to have the Android Wear companion app on your phone, and yeah, it needs at least Android 4.3, because that one has access to notifications, system right, and it makes use of at least Google Play Service 5.0, so you need these. But yeah, meanwhile we are at 6.5, right, so you all should have it already. And yeah, what it does, it basically syncs all the information between the phone and the wearable device. So for example, the notifications, you have to activate the accessibility that this app can read all your notifications on your phone and push it to your wear device. And it pushes all the wear applications that you download from the Play Store, push it to these devices here. So a wear application would be packaged inside a normal APK, a normal phone app that you release on the Play Store. And inside this, there would be an APK for the wear device. And this app or the Google Play service would push this internal APK to the watch. So yeah, and in this app you can do some more stuff. For example, define default applications to react on some voice actions and so on, and activate Bluetooth debugging, stuff like that. But yeah, let's have a look at the development side a bit. What can you do with the notifications for the Wear? So per default, all the notifications you have on your phone also come up here. It works out of the box. So when you do this inside your application, it's a normal behavior like you do a notification. It already works on the wearable device. It's already supported out of the box. The only thing you need to think of here is that you use the latest, not the latest anymore, but the notification compat from the support library. And then again, you can do some adjustments just for the wearable device. For example, add some actions to the notification that just get shown on the wearable device. So you've seen these blue buttons on the right to a notification. These are actually the actions you would see on the phone beneath the notification itself. And yeah, you can add some custom ones just for the wear. For example, an action that says, open this kind of information on your phone. You don't want to have this action on your phone itself, right? And then again, when you have some security sensitive information in the notification, you can, of course, say, don't show this notification on your wearable device, because when you are around people, you all can see what I have here, right? Keep that in mind when you do notifications. And then you can also add some additional information to a notification that wouldn't appear on the phone. So these are called pages. You can see it on the bottom image here. So when you would swipe the upper card there to the right, no, to the left, you go to the right, it would show the second page of this notification. That is technically just one more notification that just has a context text set, and you just add it to the first notification using this variable extender. Yeah, also for the all the where specific stuff you do on notifications, always use the variable extender. That's the one you need, and that's the only difference you need for the where stuff. Yeah, and as I said, you need the support library v420 at least for it. This comes with the notification compat that does the stuff and that supports the variable extender, and the variable extender does the adjustments itself. So, but when you do full-fledged apps on these devices, these devices don't have a network connection on zone, so but they need some data, right? So what you would have to do is always talk to your phone and get the data from there. So for example, when you want to see an image here, you would say, hey phone, download this image from the network, and the phone would push it to the wearable device. So there are, to do this, there are basically three APIs. First, the Node API that gives you some callbacks you can use to get informed about when a wearable device gets connected or disconnected, and to identify these devices. You could also have several watches on one phone. And the second one is the Messages API. That's something just to send some small piece of information, a fire and forget command, basically. So that's the one you would use to say, to tell the phone, hey, I need some data, I need some information, give it to me. And then you would use the data API on the phone to put this huge data, for example, an image, to the wearable device. And the data API is actually quite powerful. So it always keeps the data in sync between the devices. So when you add something to this one data store on the wearable device, it's automatically here and the other way around. And there are not really several ways to use the API on different devices, but it's just one data store, and you use the completely same methods and APIs on this one like on this one. And you just handle it like one storage. So, and yeah, then it also caches it. So for example, when you want to have the same image again on the wearable device, and it's got already transferred before, then it's still there, so it's cached. And all these three APIs are part of the Google Play services. As I said, Google Play Service 5.0 and above, they have the so-called wearable service APIs. And these service APIs are also available as a separate library. Yeah, now with Play Service 6.5, it's all separated anyway, but this was already before. But on these full-fledged applications you maybe want to do on these devices, how do you do the UI? So there are some special widgets Google provides. For example, some basic box inset layout that makes sure that you don't need to care about if it's a round device or a square device. You just have one container where you can put your content, and it takes care of how it's laid out. Then there's, for example, a confirmation activity. So with all these three animations you see, they are completely done inside this confirmation activity. You just have to call confirmation activity, put some intent extra to it, for example, a success extra, then this would show up. Then this one is for when you want to open something from your where on the phone. This animation is also already done. So just say, I want to show the confirmation activity for open something on my phone, and then the error message is also already done. Just say it's an error one. So they have some prepared stuff for these devices, actually, that, yeah, you don't need to do a lot, actually, on the UI. Besides maybe the content itself. So for example, this is a card fragment that's also already done, completely how it looks, and it already provides this sliding up of the card. So for example, that it covers at first just the bottom half of the screen, and then if you slide it up, it shows the whole content. And then when you want to do some UI like the context stream, where you can slide horizontally and vertically, you can use a grid view pager. I guess all of you know the view pager. Now there's a grid view pager that does it in two dimensions. And there's also the fragment adapter for it that can use the card fragments I showed before. But this stuff is actually pretty buggy still. For example, when you provide an adapter that doesn't have any data, so zero items, it just crashes. So it's still, yeah, you have to be aware of some stuff. And then there are some more widgets, like yeah, a circle image view to do these round buttons, or a dismiss overlay view that does the so there's a pattern on the wear devices. When you long press it, it goes back to the context stream. So that's also already done in this dismiss overlay view. There's actually a lot of useful stuff, but they're all a bit buggy. So, and that's why I guess this library that does have all these widgets, it's not really an official product from Google. So they say it's not, it's unofficial, and I don't know, I think of it like a 20% project from on Google or something like that. So you have to be aware of it when you use that. Also, it's not available in the Maven repository, so you have to actually download the library itself. Also the documentation for it, it's not online and so on. Yeah, and you can find all this on developers.android.com/where. I hope you all know that and have taken a look at it. It's I quite like to development for these devices. I'm doing my own application right now. I actually hope to show it today, but it didn't finish. And yeah, let's have a look at actual devices. So I guess you all know these two. They launched with, so these are the first two devices that launched in at Google I/O this year. So the LG one and the Samsung one, they are pretty stable. So Android Wear was developed on these two devices. But then, as a user, you want a bit more, right? Like this beautiful thing. It's actually beautiful, but when you want to do development with Android Wear, don't get this. So, for example, it doesn't have a real USB connection that you can use. The USB connection is behind the band, actually. So you cannot use it, and you just can do Bluetooth debugging, for example, and that's just way too slow to do real development. Don't get this when you want to develop. And then there's a kind of second generation coming. I guess the round LG one and the Sony one are already launched. I already saw people having that. So the Motorola has a problem that the screen is not really round, but there's a bottom that is, where the screen is a bit cut. That has technical reasons. So LG managed to do a round one, but they also tricked. They put a layer on top of the screen. And because of that, you maybe get some problems with covered layouts at the edges. And then there's the Sony one. I actually prefer that one. When I would have to buy a device. Personally, I would get the Sony one. I like Sony. They have a lot of experience with watches, so they did smartwatch 1 and 2 before, and I had the second one. It was actually pretty good. Yeah, it also has GPS. That's the only one that has that. And then, yeah, I like it. And then there's the ASUS Zen watch coming. I think it already got released. I'm not sure. Yeah. And then, yeah, but Google tends to do a bit more with partnering. So what I'm interested in from all these partners especially is Fossil. So Fossil, before smartwatches, I always had Fossil watches and I really liked them. And they are partnering actually with Intel. So there's a style from Fossil and the skills, the technical skills from Intel, and I'm expecting some great stuff from them. Yeah, but you could ask, where's Lollipop for Wear, right? I mean, just had the Lollipop talk from Benjamin, and there's some nifty new stuff. Maybe you don't need all of them for a Wear device, but yeah, it would be nice to have the same APIs. Yeah, and the rumor mill says it's coming in December, but of course there's no official point from Google regarding this. And yeah, but what's known is there will be new watch faces, a complete official watch face API. Up until now, there's just some hacky way to do watch faces, no official API, but there's coming something. And yeah, a lot of UI improvements and way more settings, way more stuff you can actually personalize your watch with. Yeah, that's basically it for me. So when you have questions, feel free to ask now. Now's the chance.
Yeah, so please raise your hand so I can come with the microphone. One question here.
Thanks for the talk. I would like to know when I started Wear development, I ran into the problem that I have to link closed source libraries to my projects, like the Google Play services. Do you know any alternative, maybe alternative implementation of the communication that is open source?
No, not that I know of. I know the full Bluetooth stack is there, just with the normal Android APIs, but I don't know anyone who started doing its own stuff there.
Okay, thanks.
Any other question? Yeah.
Thank you. For the custom actions you can add to notifications, do you know if you can set the images or the graphic resources?
Yeah, sure. Just normal as on notifications, you can set the images there.
Any icon, basically.
Yes.
Okay.
A quick question to follow that up. If you use an icon, you get the blue circle as background, right?
You mean for an action, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So, any other questions? No? Oh.
Okay. When you use ongoing notifications with Android, you know that probably the notification manager adds a new action, which is mute app, automatically. Do you know if it's possible to know when the user clicks that action?
You mean that's an API from Lollipop?
No, just a simple ongoing notification, like the one that stays always there, like when you have a service running in background. Okay. No worries.
I just don't know which.
Okay, no worries.
What do you mean?
Show you later.
Yeah, we can talk about it afterwards.
More questions?
Just a little hardware question. What sensors are usually built in those devices? Which kind of sensors are usually built in those devices?
Actually, I didn't have a look at all the sensors. It has an accelerometer. So this one also has a heart rate sensor, but I didn't touch this yet. So, but we can look it up maybe.
Yeah. So not too many, but there's also one watch that has GPS, which is nice, I guess.
But generally, there's support for all that in Android Wear. Just the hardware has to have it.
Hi. What kind of Wear application are you working on? And can you show us some code?
I'm building a Wear app on top of the open Car2Go API. So on Android Wear, there's an intent in the system to call a car. And in Germany, there's no app that supports that. And yeah, so you can just say, OK, Google, get me a car, or something like that. And then my app would show you a list of Car2Go cars in the area. And yeah, then you could just book it by one press. That's what I'm building. I plan to open source it, but right now it's in a hacky state. And so the most stuff is working, but I wouldn't want to show the code, actually, because it's damn ugly right now.
Are there any other questions? Well, then, I have a question. So would you also use the data API if your Wear app has some settings and you save the stuff? Can you use the data API to sync it to the phone?
What kind of settings do you mean, for an app or what?
Yeah, so imagine you have a Wear app that does something more than notifications. You can configure it, I don't know, have a fancy setting. You have to store the current state of that setting, and you want to sync it back to the phone.
Oh, that would work.
Does the data API work if you're not currently not connected to the phone?
So it stores the stuff here then? I didn't actually try without connected yet, but I think it stores the stuff on the storage here, and then when it gets connected, it syncs it over.
Okay, that would be nice. Does anyone know, maybe? For sure? No? Okay. Any other questions?
Does Wear actually work with two devices, like you have two watches on your wrist?
So actually, I just wear it because I wanted to show both. And when someone wants to try it out and compare them, so that would be the chance after the talk. But usually, I just use that one and that one just for development. But it works. You can have several Wear devices on your phone, and then all the notifications would come to both. And but in your own applications, you can use the Node API to identify which device you want to talk with.
Okay, there's another question back there.
Did you try to connect one watch to two devices, let's say the phone and the tablet or something like that?
As far as I know, that doesn't work.
Okay.
Can you connect one watch to the other watch?
No.
Yeah, I don't know what that would be good for, but it would be cool.
You want to do a push chain, right?
Yeah, but I don't know. Just do it and then figure out what it's good for later. So, any other questions?
Interestingly, on the Node API, is that they, inside the documentation, they never talk about Wear devices or phones or whatever. They just say the device is a Node. And what I expect is when they bring TVs and cars and they want to maybe use the data sync message and Node API for all of these devices. And at some point, you maybe get a big network then. That's my guess.
Yeah, so I guess we look at the API now rather than later. So, any other questions? Then I guess we are off.